So once again, welcome back to the scientific session two. The theme for the scientific session two is reviewing and generating evidences for occupational therapy early intervention and developmental approaches. For this scientific session to chair, we have Dr. Anjali Joshi Madam and Dr. U. Ganapathy Sankar Sir with us. Yeah. So this is the disclaimer. Everybody would have seen that in the previous presentation as well, previous scientific sessions as well. So to begin with, Dr. Anjali Joshi Madam, she has done an MSc in OT and also fellow of AIOTA. She is also a sensory integration certified from USC California. She is a consultant and pediatric occupational therapist and a visiting consultant for neonatal and international parents and professional groups of children with special needs. She is a volunteering professional also in multi-agency international training and support MITS in UK and WHO. She is also into the editorial board of Annals of International Occupational Therapy. She is also the recipient of the Spandan Award by Ministry of MSJE Social Empowerment for the work in the field of disability. The second chairperson with us we have is Dr. U. Ganapathy Sir. So currently he is the Dean of SRM College of Occupational Therapy, the PhD in Occupational Therapy as well. He is the National Editorial Board Member of Indian Journal of Physiotherapy and Occupational Therapy since 2018. He is also the Associate Editor in Indian Journal of Occupational Therapy since April 2020. He has been reviewer for American Journal of Occupational Therapy, British Journal of Occupational Therapy, as well as Journal of Autism and Developmental Disabilities. He's also the recipient of Fellow of ACOT Award in 2020. He has n number of presentations and research publications to begin with the Scopus Index journals in 72 numbers. He has as many as 129 publications in national and international journals. He has also one book published to his name, and also he is the BS of SRM and PG teacher for 36 MOT students in SRM University. So this scientific session has total 8 papers. I would like to invite both the chairperson to take over for the proceeding of the scientific session. Over to you, Joshi Madam and Ganapathy Sir.
Thank you, Somakant, for such a warm, lovely introduction. And good afternoon, everybody. I'm sure you all had good food for thought and your lunch too before we start this session. I have with me Dr. U. Ganapathy Sankar chairing the session today. And with your permission, Dr. Ganapathy, let's begin the session.
Yes, ma'am, you can proceed.
Yeah. So the session, as Dr. Sriharsh mentioned, has been sponsored by AFA and UDAN. And I now call upon the first speaker here, Dr. Avasthi Deepa, and her topic of her presentation is going to be a systematic review of different pain assessment scales used in neonates. Over to you, Deepa.
Good afternoon, everyone. Good afternoon, all. And my title of the study is a systematic review of different pain assessment scales used in neonates. Introduction. Neonates have a pain threshold that is 30 to 50% lower than that of adults. Although the survival of these neonates in the neonatal intensive care unit is reliant on various unpleasant and painful medical interventions that can rapidly evoke the stress response. The frequent activation of this stress response can impact the neonate's brain development by activation of the hypothalamic pituitary adrenal axis of the endocrine system. Need for this study lies in the fact that the neonates cannot speak and advocate for themselves when they experience pain, which is the gold standard for pain measurement in other age groups. Pain assessment forms the backbone of successful implementation of non-pharmacological pain management techniques used by occupational therapists in neonates. The prevalence of numerous existing pain assessment scales to neonates results in difficulty in discerning the most appropriate measure for the neonates' clinical context. Aim of the study is to analyze the use of various pain scales used in different clinical contexts in preterm and full-term neonates, while the objectives of the study is to analyze 18 neonatal pain assessment scales considering different dimensions that assess acute, prolonged, and postoperative pain in preterm and full-term neonates to analyze the type of pain measured in the target gestation age group assessed by the various pain assessment scales, analyzing the psychometric properties of the considered pain assessment measures used in neonates. The methodology The study is a systematic review, and the following mentioned scientific literature databases were searched from the time of conception until October 2019. A search strategy was established combining the subject headings and preterms. The subject headings involved gestational age group of the target population with respect to preterm and full term infants, the type of pain measured, dimensionality of the scales, items and scale components, reliability, validity, and the availability of the scales. The search strategy also involved three terms of text words as mentioned, and references from key papers were also scanned to ensure that all the key studies were included. The inclusion criteria involved freely available neonatal pain measurement scales, assessment suitable for use in preterm and full-term infants up till 1 month of corrected age, studies stating the scale characteristics, psychometric properties, and their use in clinical settings from the time of conception until October 2019, reviews on neonatal pain evaluations from the time of conception until October 2019. The exclusion criteria involved scales with manual which were not published or commercially available, scales for which only abstract was available, assessment measures not published in English, and the studies in which the data was in a preliminary stage of validation were excluded from the current study. Evaluation procedure, the selected neonatal pain assessment measures were systematically analyzed for the dimensionality with respect to the uni or multidimensionality of the scale, the type of neonatal pain measured by the scale with respect to acute postoperative or chronic pain, the target gestational age group that was assessed by the scale with respect to preterm or full-term infants, the scale items or components that were scored by the assessment with respect to facial expression, crying, behavioral state, and physiological state. Reliability, that is the inter and the inter-rater reliability, pace, content, construct, and concurrent validity. Results showed 9 freely available unidimensional scales that were included in the study, namely the neonatal facial coding system, behavioral pain scale, behavioral indicator of infant pain, the FLACC or the face, legs, activity, cry, consolability scale, the Comfort Neo, children and infants post-operative pain scale, the Children's Hospital of Eastern Ontario pain scale, Edin and Dan, and 9 freely available multidimensional pain assessment scales were included in the study, namely the premature infant pain profile, the neonatal pain agitation and sedation scale, the neonatal pain assessment tool, modified pain assessment tool, Comfort, the neonatal infant pain scale, modified infant pain scale, cries, and the covers. The target gestational age group involved 7 unidimensional scales that were validated for using preterm as well as full-term infants, while only 2 unidimensional scales were validated for use in preterm infants only. 8 of the multidimensional scales considered in the current study were validated for use in preterm as well as full-term infants, as mentioned, and only 1, which is the MIPS, was validated for use in full-term infants only. As also depicted in the chart, 3 unidimensional scales measured acute pain, which is the NFPS, DAN, and BIIP, 3 measured post-operative pain, namely the FLACC, CHIPS, and CHOPS, and 3 measured prolonged pain, which is the BPS, Edin, and Comfort Neo. 4 multidimensional scales measured acute pain, namely the PIPP, NIPS, NPAT, and covers. 4 measured post-operative pain, namely the Comfort, MPAT, MIPS, and CRIES. And only 1 multidimensional scale measured prolonged pain, that is the NPAT. As represented in the chart, 7 unidimensional scales included facial expressions, the scale component, while none of the unidimensional scales considered in the current review have considered physiological state of the neonate as a scale parameter. Although all the unidimensional scales that have been considered in the study included behavioral state as a scale component. The reliability of the neonatal pain assessment scale as depicted, 50% of the unidimensional scales demonstrated inter and intra-rater reliability, while only 70% of the multidimensional scales demonstrated inter-rater reliability and only 30% demonstrated intra-rater reliability. The validity of the included neonatal pain assessment scale is as depicted, and most of the scales considered or possessed construct validity, which is 46% and 36% for uni and multidimensional scales respectively. Discussion. Maria Carmenza et al. Conducted a cross-sectional study which concluded that unidimensional pain assessment measures are more sensitive to the identification of pain in full-term infants. However, in preterm infants, a multi-facet scale component in the multidimensional scales reveal increased sensitivity for pain analysis. In the current study, 3 multidimensional scales included all the 4 components that have been considered in the study, namely the NPAS, covers, and the MIPS. Although NPAS and covers are validated for use in preterm as well as full-term neonates, MIPS is only validated for use in full-term infants. Similarly, NPAS measures prolonged pain, cover measures acute pain, and MIPS measures post-operative pain. Therefore, the discern and the use of these scales will depend upon the clinical context of a particular neonate. In the current review, the most widely used neonatal pain scales for research was the premature infant pain profile, or commonly known as the PIPP. And this is also the only scale in the current review that scores the gestational age of the neonate, and therefore it is suggested for use in extremely preterm infants, along with the NPAS, so the neonatal pain agitation, the sedation scale, which is also the only scale in the current review that scores the heart rate and the blood pressure of the neonate, and therefore suggested for use in ventilated neonates. The FLAPC and CHIPS are the two unidimensional, while the NIPS and the PIPP are the two multidimensional scales considered in the current review that showed the strongest psychometric properties. Limited availability of adequate data regarding the psychometric properties of the scales is indicative of inherent challenges for pain evaluation in neonates. The lack of any prerequisites like training or certification for any of the considered assessment measures in the current study reflect on the need for skill-based evaluation of these neonates with varying performance. Limitations of the study lie that only freely available neonatal pain assessment measures were included in the study. The scales that were published in languages other than English were not considered, and individual scale characteristics of all of the included scales have not been discussed in detail, while a conclusive ranking of all the included neonatal pain assessment measures is not provided. Conclusion: neonatal care providers must discern a pain assessment scale based on the knowledge of its characteristics, gestational age, the type of painful stimulus, and most importantly, the environmental context of the neonate. Skillful assessment of neonatal pain using uni and multidimensional scales with adequate psychometric properties is suggested. Further research regarding the implication of the clinical utility of these neonatal pain assessment tools is recommended, especially in the Indian context. I extend my gratitude to my mentor and the head of the department and the team of Oticon 2021. These are my references. Thank you.
This is good presentation, Deepa. I just wanted to ask you, how do you plan to use the, I mean, you said you do not have, I mean, that's one of the limitations that you really not looked at how to use it. But what's your plan in mind? Like, once you've got this scale and you're looking at pain management or pain in neonates, this understanding, how are you going to use in your clinical practice?
Ma'am, most importantly, we as occupational therapists are involved in the use of non-pharmacological pain management techniques in neonates and the NICU. And therefore, the knowledge of the correct pain assessment scale will help us in better analysis of the pain and choosing the most appropriate strategy for a particular neonate, and the one that is also most feasible and appropriate for a particular neonate within his clinical context. And this is also very important to have an overview of all the assessment scales, because even though pain analysis is so crucial, there is no universal approach for neonatal pain assessment. So therefore, the clinical implications of the correct pain assessment will help me as occupational therapist to use the correct pain management program that we design for a neonate within the neonate's clinical context.
Great. So I'm sure you will think about what that management program will be, which I see you probably haven't given a thought to, but please, all the best to you for that.
Thank you.
Okay.
My own questions, can I ask, ma'am?
Yes, go ahead, I think. There were two questions are allowed, so it's okay.
Very good presentation. So
thank you, sir.
I have one question. What is systematic review?
Systematic review is one of the reviews that involves a only the quantitative studies. Unlike other reviews, systematic review is the one that involves all the, it is a secondary data research that involves all the quantitative studies only. And like in systematic review, only quantitative studies have been reviewed and none of the qualitative studies have been reviewed.
Yeah. Based on the paper, you explain how many scales available. Systematic review means you have to collect research article. Level 1, level 2, yes. Level 3. How many articles related to neonatal pain scale? So how many research used pain scale for neonatal? Then based on that, these are the scale, these are the level 1 evidence, pain scales used, level 2, 5 scale. Likewise, if you present, that is systematic review. This is just you pick the, what are the scales available, and analyze the reliability and validity. That is not systematic review. Then again, your analysis, you mentioned content validity is 27%. Is it adequate? then indirect reliability is very less both. So I think you have to change the terminology. Instead of systematic review, this analysis of pain scale for neonate, then it is the apt for your topic. Very good presentation, but the systematic review give the different picture to audience.
Okay.
That is my suggestion.
Okay.
All the best.
Thank you. Thank you, sir.
Next, I call upon the second presenter, Dr. Ukte Yashwanti Vilas. The topic is effect of oculomotor intervention program on fine motor coordination and balance in children with learning disabilities from age group of 8 to 12 years.
Hello, good afternoon, sir. Good afternoon, ma'am. The topic of my presentation is effect of oculomotor intervention program on fine motor coordination and balance in children with learning disabilities aged 8 to 12 years. Introduction. Specific learning disability refers to the condition where children of any age demonstrate a substantial deficit in an aspect of academic achievement because of language, memory, motor functions, and perceptual impairment, regardless of any etiology or other contributing factors. Problems with balance and fine coordinated activities are present, which can be associated due to oculomotor dysfunction. Oculomotor control, which is the voluntary or reflex control movement of the eye, includes persuades, fixation, seconds. Persuades are the slower tracking movements. Fixation is a fixation of both eyes on a particular object or place. Seconds are quick and simultaneous movements of the eye. Oculomotor dysfunction occurs when there is absence of or defect of controlled, voluntary, and purposeful eye movement. Fine motor skills essential for self-care tasks and academic tasks requires eye-hand coordination, where the eyes control and guide the hand to perform the task. Balance is an ability to maintain the line of gravity of the body within the base of the support with minimal postural sway. Maintaining it requires coordination from multiple sensory systems, including vestibular, somatosensory, and visual system. Therefore, the current study was designed to assess the presence of oculomotor dysfunction in children with learning disabilities and to study the effects of oculomotor intervention program on fine motor coordination and balance in these children. Aim of the study was to determine the effect of oculomotor intervention program on fine motor coordination and balance in children with oculomotor dysfunctions in learning disabilities. Objectives were to screen oculomotor programs in children with learning disabilities aged 8 to 12 years, to study the effect of oculomotor intervention program on fine motor coordination and balance in children with learning disabilities. Methodology, the type of study is cross-sectional, prospective, and quasi-experimental. The sample size was 34 children with learning disabilities. Inclusion criteria, children of both gender, boys and girls diagnosed with learning disabilities of age group 8 to 12 years, children having type 2 and above behavior on DEM test, that is developmental eye movement test. Type 2 behavior is characteristic of oculomotor dysfunction. Children with ability to understand verbal and demonstrated instructions to follow it appropriately. Exclusion criteria, with children with visual impairment or any condition affecting their vision. Children with any neurological, musculoskeletal, psychiatric, cognitive dysfunction or other diseases or disorders. Test battery, first is a screening tool, developmental eye movement test. This test determines saccadic eye movements efficiency both based on both the speed and accuracy that a series of single digit numbers can be located, recognized, and verbalized rapidly. Oculomotor performance is judged based on the time needed to complete the test as well as the level of accuracy. These are the subtests, subtest A and B, which are the vertical tests. This is subtest C, horizontal test of DEM. The errors are substitutions, omission, addition, and transpositions. Interpretations can be four. First is the normal. Second, type 2 behavior is characteristic of oculomotor dysfunction. Type 3 behavior is difficulty in automaticity in number calling skills. And type 4 is deficiencies in oculomotor skills. Second is outcome measure, that is BOT2, Bruning's Oscillatory test of motor proficiency. It assesses the motor functioning of the children. Only three subtests were included: fine motor precision, fine motor integration, and balance. Test procedure. 60 children were screened using DEM test, out of which 34 children having oculomotor dysfunction and falling in criteria type 2 and above behavior on DEM test were included in the study for oculomotor intervention program. Fine manual control and balance subtest of BOT2 was administered on them and the scores were recorded for the same. Children included in the study were treated using oculomotor intervention program twice a week for a period of 6 weeks, and each session lasted for 40 minutes. There were two follow-ups done on these children where they were reassessed using BOT2 at the end of 3 weeks and at the end of 6 weeks. The scores recorded for BOT2 were compared pre and post intervention. This is the oculomotor intervention program from week 1 to 3, which included volitional visual tracking exercises, which included a light beam exercises, light beam activity, which had a horizontal at eye level, diagonally at eye level, and vertically at eye level. The second was depth perception requiring convergence and divergence. So that activity included prone on platform swing and various activities performed on the platform swing. Monitoring periphery while maintaining central vision for targets, including blow toy activity, where a whistle was used while completing the obstacle course. Other activities were also included in the first week, first phase of the intervention, which had a toss beach ball with letters or words written on it, hit a ball or a balloon which was stationary, and all other activities like mazes, hopscotch, puzzles. The second phase was from weeks 4 to 6, which included all the similar activities. Additional was movements in coordination with visual fixation and quick localization. It was an infinity walk, which had a figure of eight pattern walking, which was helpful for conversion and divergence. These are the activities. Results and discussion. This table represents distribution of intervened participants as per their age. So distribution of intervened children were 9 from 8 years, 9 from 9 years, 3 from 10 years, and 5 from 11 years, and 8 from 12 years. So a supporting study by Megan Silvey Benzer shows the effect of oculomotor vestibular proprioceptive sensory stimulation program on reading skills in children aged 8 to 12 years. This is figure 2, which has distribution of behavior, DM behavior, type 2, 3, and 4. 16 were falling in type 2, 13 were falling in type 3, and 5 were falling in type 4. Table 2, this is the comparison of fine motor precision scores of study participants at baseline and 6 weeks. So non-parametric test of Wilcoxon sign rank test was used. There was significant difference between the median scores at baseline and 6 weeks post-intervention in fine motor precision. This is the graphical representation of fine motor precision scores. So total improvement post 6 weeks for fine motor precision was 51.89%. Various activities included in the oculomotor program also helped in fine motor precision. So supporting article described the functional impact on fine motor tasks like writing and copying in children with amblyopia. Table number 3 represents fine motor integration scores at baseline at 6 weeks. There was a significant difference between the median scores post 6 weeks intervention. Graphical representation of fine motor integration scores. Total improvement of post 6 weeks was 29.33%. Various activities in the program which helped with school skill acquisition like handwriting activities and fine motor activity were given. So a similar supporting article by Kimron et al. Suggested enhancement in skill acquisition post oculomotor training. These are the balance scores for participants post 6 weeks. There was significant difference between the median scores at baseline and at 6 weeks post intervention. Graphical representation of balance scores. Total improvement was 36.61. Supporting articles showed performing prosecret improved postural stability. Conclusion, oculomotor intervention program included activities related to volitional visual tracking, oculomotor coordination, depth perception, and monitoring periphery while maintaining central vision. These activities help to improve coordination of head, body, and eye movement. To conclude, significant change was seen in fine motor precision, fine motor integration, and balance in children with learning disabilities post-oculomotor intervention. Recommendation for the further studies are DM type 2, 3, and 4 behavior can be divided into each group to compare them in individually for further studies. Further studies can assess postural stability post-oculomotor intervention and its effect on balance. Thank you. These are the references.
Very nice presentation. I have one clarification. So in your study, how did you control confounding variable in your study?
Sorry, sir?
How did you control confounding variable influence your study?
So this was a study which include.
Yeah.
This was a study which included a particular group. There was no comparison. So pre and post only.
That is
for the program. We had
My question is, rather than your intervention,
yes,
some of the other variable may influence your study result. So yes, your intervention is oculomotor, only oculomotor. Maybe other intervention influence your study result, they also show some positive result after 6 weeks. So what are the measures taken by investigator to control influence of confounding variable in your research?
Thank you for the question, sir. The population which was included in the study had been not going for other intervention till this oculomotor intervention program was given. So not other rehabilitation services like which any learning disability children usually go. The history was taken properly, and they were currently for the 6 weeks, there was no other activities or therapy going on.
I think you are not getting my question.
Yeah, I think probably you need to have that discussion with her later. Looks like she's not getting the question. Yeah. Any other questions are there, or can I ask a question? I mean, if there are more questions, I'll refrain.
Ma'am, you can ask.
Ma'am, okay. There is a question.
Yeah, go ahead.
Dr. Yashwanti, what is the efficacy level of your interventional activities? Any evidence available?
There are many evidences, but not purely for occupational therapy. Many optometrists work on oculomotor intervention program. So the research which I have found for oculomotor intervention for purely occupational therapy is minimal, but I have got results where occupational therapists have used this for specifically for learning disability kids. So there is improvement in their skills.
Okay. Should we call upon the third speaker?
Yes.
Yeah. Thank you. Thank you for your presentation, Yashwanti. And now I call upon the third speaker for today, Dr. Divesha Shikerkar. Her topic is Understanding Daily Routine and Schedule of Children with Attention Deficit Hyperactivity Disorder in Goa, India. And as you all know, this session has been supported by Akhil Autism Foundation and DAN. So third speaker, please, Divesha.
Yes, good afternoon, everyone. My research topic is Understanding Daily Routine and Schedule in Children with Attention Deficit Hyperactivity Disorder in Goa, India, a qualitative study. The background is ADHD consists of inattention, hyperactivity, and impulsivity. The ADHD symptoms impair the development and functioning of children as they show disinhibition in social relationships and poor adherence to social norms. There are some more difficulties of children with ADHD include difficulty in managing their daily chores, difficulty in scheduling their daily activities, restless behavior at home and in school, and difficulty in turn taking or finishing their classwork and homework. ADHD impacts quality of life, daily activity functioning, and routine of the children and their family. The impact on child's routine and daily functional performance is believed due to the presence of the core symptoms of ADHD, sometimes the deficits in sensory processing abilities, and or the poor time processing abilities and daily time management skills. So the need of the study is, as there are previous studies done which state that children with ADHD have affected difficulty in functioning, but there are very limited studies which suggest the qualitative analysis of these routines and schedules. There is a need to develop an assessment tool and intervention technique to enhance the participation of these children with ADHD in their daily life, focusing on the difficulties. Hence, it is of utmost importance to understand the daily routine and schedule of the child with ADHD. The purpose of my study was to understand daily routine and schedule of children with ADHD in Goa and India. And the objective was to understand the daily routine and schedule of children with ADHD qualitatively using a semi-structured questionnaire. The methodology ethical clearance was obtained from the Institutional Ethics Committee at Goa Medical College. Qualitative descriptive study design was used, and the study was conducted on parents of children having ADHD in resource rooms and schools of Goa. The sample size consisted of 10 parents of children with ADHD who were residing in Goa, India. These are my inclusion exclusion criteria. The inclusion criteria for the child participant was age group from 7 to 12 years and those who had informed consent, and the exclusion criteria was not in accordance with the diagnostic criteria of ADHD, children below 7 or above age of 12 years, and lack of consent. Semi-structured qualitative guide to understand the daily routine and schedule of children with ADHD was used. Explored included the structure of routine, home and school routine, effect of this routine on the child and parents, and the changes expected, and the importance of routine. The data collection and analysis was conducted in the following steps. In-depth interviews were conducted. Expanded notation and transcription was done into the English. Authentication of the translated notation was done by my guide. There was coding of interviews, which was done manually on the Excel sheets. The coding tree was developed based on the data available, and initial themes understanding the daily routine and schedule were derived. And the quotes were explored for this study, which were depicting the understanding of the daily routine and schedule of children with ADHD. The results of my study. The study described the understanding of the daily routine and schedule of children with ADHD. A total of 10 parents of children with ADHD were interviewed for the study. Following, four key themes emerged from the data analysis, namely structure of the routine, home and school routine, effect of this routine on the child and parents, and the changes expected, and the importance of routine in daily life. These are the demographic characteristics of my parent participants and the child participants. These were the themes that were emerged. Coming to the first theme, the structure of routine. As reported by all the parents, the child had no fixed routine for daily activities, no fixed free time or play time, and parents reported of having difficulty in managing the activities of their child. He or she doesn't realize the time to do any chores and keeps on running around in the house unless I force her or him to do the work, is what one of the parents quoted. Some of the parents also said that the child has most of the day as his or her free time or play time. Most of the parents said that their child is okay if their daily routine tasks are not followed and he or she is set free throughout the day. He is free whenever he wants to be. He gets irritated if I try to limit or restrict his free time. He escapes the house if I reduce his free time, were also some of the comments the parents made. The second theme was routine in home and school. In home routine, all the parents reported that the child does not have any fixed time to carry out his or her self-care, mealtime, and bedtime routine, and takes very little or too much of time to do daily routine tasks like bathing, brushing, or eating. The parents also quoted, he eats when he feels like, doesn't do bathing if he doesn't wish, and he does the routine activities only when asked or forced to do it. He takes more than 30 minutes to bathe himself or to eat his food. He doesn't sleep at night unless the lights are put off. In their school routine, all of the parents said that their child is not punctual to go to school most of the times. Some of the parents said that they get complaints from teachers as the child doesn't sit at one place, doesn't copy anything from the board or write in class, and is always found running around. The child keeps tearing the pages of his notebooks and or snatches everyone else's notebooks. The parent said, teacher always complains to me that he keeps moving around in the class and tears the pages. He or she misses the bus and then I often have to drop him to school. The third theme was effect of current routine on parents and children and the changes recommended in routine. Parents reported disturbed sleep and poor schedule of other family members, decrease in socialization, negligence towards other children and imbalance in their family finances as some of the effects on their routine. And as per the parents, this current schedule is affecting the child's productivity, behavior, and indirectly his or her future. There is an impact on our financial condition. Because of his extra free time, he is hardly productive and keeps moving around, were some of the comments. The changes parents wanted in their child's routine included decreased free time, structuring the daily routine, increase in study time, reducing the moving around and hyperactive behavior, and engaging the child as much as possible throughout the day. He has to structure his day, be productive, and calm down, was the statement made by many parents. The last theme was importance of routine. All of the parents said that having a routine in life is very important as it helps to have a balance in family and work life, plan things properly, have a discipline in life, and shape behavior and have a bright future. A good and structured routine sets a balance in life, thus shaping behavior, was a comment. Parents said that a good routine will help the child learn good habits in life, such as punctuality, discipline, and being well-mannered, which will shape their behavior and future. Discussion. This study explored the parents' difficulties in managing the child for carrying out the routine task activities like self-care, bedtime, and mealtime routine. The study also highlighted how the unstructured daily routine of poor self-care, bedtime, and mealtime of the child affected the parent life, leading to disturbed sleep schedule, lack of rest, poor socialization, financial difficulties, and negligence towards the other child in the form of lack of attention and affection. This study indicated that the current routine of the child with ADHD disorder had altered the routine of the child, the parents, as well as other family members, thereby hampering the performance of productive and meaningful occupations. And the study also spoke about the school routine difficulties of children, like poor punctuality, poor study schedule, mischievous and hyperactive behavior. Finally, the study stated the importance of routine for the parents and family members as something which balances the life of the child, helps plan ahead, have a disciplined life, and shape behavior for a better future. All these findings were in accordance with the studies those were conducted till date. The implications of this study for occupational therapy practice is to aid in thorough understanding of the daily routine and schedule and difficulties and problems faced by the parents in managing the daily activities. It will help occupational therapists to develop an assessment tool for evaluation of the daily routines and schedules in children with ADHD and to have an intervention to manage the affected routine areas. The limitations of my study were limited time constraint and small sample size. Conclusion, the parents of children with ADHD have difficulty in managing the daily routine of their child at home as well as in school, including the self-care routine, mealtime, bedtime routine, and study schedule. My study also discovered about the effect of this routine on the child as well as parents and helped understand the importance of routine in daily life to carry out meaningful occupations. These are some of my references. I would like to acknowledge all the participants for their cooperation and participation in the study. The Dean of my college, Dr. S.M. Bandekar, for his constant support, Dr. Vivek Vajratkar, for providing and guiding me throughout the research process, and of course, my guide, Dr. Pooja Vajratkar, for constantly being there for whenever I approached her. I would also like to extend my gratitude towards the staff of Pediatric Neuro Rehabilitation Center and the resource rooms and schools of Goa for providing a conducive work environment and support to help me complete my study. Thank you.
Are there any questions here?
Yes, ma'am, it is there, one of them in the chat box. Actually, it is not the question. It's just read as mentioning Goa, India in your title implies that your study was conducted across the Goa state. So it is misleading to the reader. Please consider editing that.
Hello?
Yes. Devesha, would you like to answer?
Ma'am, could you repeat the question?
It's not a question. It's a comment from someone that when you mention in the title, it's Goa, it comes across as if you looked at the entire cross population across Goa, and that can be misleading. So you need to review the title. That was the
okay, comment. Ma'am. Yes, I cannot say very clearly that the whole population from every part of Goa was targeted.
Exactly.
But to the best of my knowledge, I considered different areas, districts and talukas, and the samples were selected.
Okay. I have one question here. The parents you interviewed,
yes,
of
ma'am,
these children with ADHD, how many parents at the end of your questionnaire felt helpless and depressed? And this question is very important because we do much more than... Go ahead.
Yes, ma'am. If you're asking me out of the tens, I would say as my questionnaire progressed, or as the interview progressed and they started opening up about the issues, I could sense that they really have difficulties, or this is putting in a situation wherein they are not able to decide what's next for them, or how is it that they have to tackle the situation wherein they actually went in depth understanding of their own child's routine.
So what's your learning out of it? Do you really want to prick those parents who are already hassled and ask them questions and make them realize how terrible the child's challenges are? Or do you want to offer intervention?
Ma'am, I would definitely like to offer intervention ahead. Like once now with my pilot study, I could understand what areas are there which are bothering the parents in the point of view for their child's future. Okay. So I would definitely like to have my intervention and based on it.
Okay. Dr. Ganapathy, would you like to ask anything? Because there are no other questions, I think.
Yes, ma'am. I have one clarification from speaker. In your study, how many mothers participated, how many fathers participated for your interview?
So there were 7 mothers and 3 fathers for the study. But when you consider the child per se, there were 8 male children and 2 female children.
All children are going to normal school or special schools?
So normal schools with resource rooms.
Okay.
Thank you. And we go to the
thank
next
you,
speaker,
sir.
Ganapathy.
Yes, ma'am. I invite next speaker, Dr. Prachi Kangarude. The topic is validation of India EPAS among professional practicing in NICU.
Good afternoon, sir, and good afternoon, ma'am. Could I start? Good afternoon, everyone. Today, I'm presenting my research on validation of India EPAS among professionals practicing in NICU. The background of the study is, because there is a decrease in perinatal mortality, there is increase of survival and long-term developmental morbidities. That is why digital approach to neurodevelopmental care in NICU is needed. India EBUS is introduced. India is an acronym for Individual Newborn Developmental Intervention Application, and EBUS, E stands for evidence-based, and US stands for ultra-smart, that is very early. SMART represents specific, measurable, accountable system in realistic solutions, and all is done in timely manner. It is a cloud-based software. The concept is individualized neuroprotective and neurodevelopmental care. All evidences are in one place. The purpose of the study is documentation analysis of the entire data, clinical assistance, provide grading in various scales, report generation, and referencing to related literature. It consists of software and it interferes training. It is in agreement with the WHO digital health intervention category. Interface training is also available, and software gives assistance with its artificial intelligence. Literature says that if we spend large number of care in first 1,000 days of life, then the later spending money will be lesser. Individuals should comprehend that the future cost burden will be lessened if the current expenditure is more for the right purpose. Heckman's curve, which is shown in the left side, which also states that if we spend more money in acute care, then the future cost burden will be reduced. These are the lacunae in the present system of the neurodevelopmental care in NICU. that is reliance on post-discharge intervention, there is reduced mortality, lack of evidence-based practice, lack of trained manpower and documentation. Reason for intervention, lot of stress on nervous system in NICU is present. Neuroprotection care will improve the outcome. There is abundant of evidence for strategies for neuroprotective care. Few components are practiced than the comprehensive care. Commonly practices components like KMC, positioning, environment, feeding, etc. Considering this lacune, digital strategies thought to be useful. That is why India eBus was introduced. What is exactly the India eBus is? Various aspects to be understood while giving neuroprotective care. That is why India eBus includes many assessments and various intervention strategies. To name few, there are various neuromotor assessments like Hamiltonian, TIMP, INFANIF, Dubowitz neurological assessment, various factors like skin care, family-centered care, etc. are there. India eBus is based on neonatal integrative developmental care model, trauma-informed care aspect, need gap, neurophysiological-based occupational therapy, digital health intervention, family-centered care, splinting, and hand hygiene. The right side upper quadrant is a corner is a dashboard of the India eBus, which are we have to enter the case and later we have to fill the data. In with the help of this India eBus, we can overview your observation of a particular newborn or hold the setup from anywhere. With the help of this software, we can monitor growth chart of the newborns. The software will give help in various video training also. Benefits of India eBus. It helps in easy documentation, accountability, its artificial intelligence, clinical assistance, new evidence generation, benefits for evidence-based practice, etc. Because of this vastness of content of India eBus, there was a need of validation of content to prioritize and make it feasible to use. Aim of the study is to check the content validity of India eBus method. Psychometric design for a cross-sectional survey was used. Ethical consideration was taken. Source of data, various professions practicing in NICU incorporated. As per inclusion criteria, participants which are professionals who are willing to fill consent form and having 1 year of clinical experience in NICU setup was enrolled. Study conducted online. Various professionals having 1 year of clinical experience like neonatal nurse, neonatologist, neonatal therapist, pediatrician, occupational therapist, physiotherapist, pediatric neurologist, pediatric surgeon were also enrolled. Participants selected by universal sampling and for content validity, 15 different professionals were enrolled. For overall development till now, LEANS approach was used. LEANS approach was used in various pediatric researches and pediatric nursing. The three stages of LEANS approach, which first stage states about development, second stage about judgment and quantification, third stage about evaluation. In the first stage of that, opinion regarding neurodevelopmental care and digital approach were collected from 91 different professionals. With this collective opinion, software were developed. In the second stage of judgment and quantification, content validity questionnaire was prepared. Questionnaire validated from different experts, ethical approval was taken. Professionals were enrolled as per the inclusion criteria in third stage of evaluation. Later, India eBus app was introduced. Access was given for next 7 to 10 days, and later, last validation form and opinion of these different professionals were collected. Measurement of content validity. India eBus composed of various assessments and interventions. That's why content validity is calculated at scale level and item level. The 5 points was evaluated, in which its relevance, its understandability, its comprehensiveness, meaningfulness, and the last is not applicable. The result obtained from 15 different professionals, in which 6 participated professionals were occupational therapist, 1 is physiotherapist, 3 neonatologist, 2 pediatrician, 2 pediatric surgeon, and 1 neonatal nursing. Out of this 15, 3 were female and 12 are the male participant. The result of a content validity index at item level, in which the various neuromotor assessment scales like Hamiltonian battery got 0.87, test of infant motor assessment got 0.93, INFANIF got 0.78, Dubowitz got 0.93, pain assessment got 0.93, developmental supportive care got 0.93, neurobehavioral observation assessment got 0.50, NeoSWAT got that is neonatal sleep wake assessment cycle got 0.87, growth monitoring 0.93, and the least is trauma informed care got 0.40. The scale level content validity indexes was also calculated using sum of item level content validity scores divided by number of items, that is 0.80. As per the average method, content validity index at scale level is 0.80, which indicates that this software got a valid accepted content validity index. Discussion. Purpose of the study is to validate the content of India eBus software. As we collected opinion from 15 different professionals, for professionals, neuromotor aspect was a priority in this approach, due to which various assessment scales like Amilton Battery, TIMP, InfaNIP got the higher validity index at the item level. This might be because of the obvious character of the motor impairment seen in newborn, also familiarity with the tool and regular use of the tool in its own setting. Pain assessment and its interpretation, all these professionals were agreed. These all factors will contribute in the enhancement of infant's mental health. Developmental supportive care includes various factors like environment, positioning, handling, family-centered care, skin care, feeding, etc., which also shows higher content validity due to its wide acceptance. Growth item also shows higher validity index due to wide use in the child developmental factors in an ICU. Neurobehavioral assessment shows lower range of content validity due to it was not commonly practiced. Obtained item level score for trauma-informed care was the least, which because of the NICU working professionals are not aware about this neurodevelopmental component. Various professionals of NICU rely on post-discharge early intervention rather than acute care, but a lot of stress of developing immature nervous system is given in acute care itself. So neuroprotection in this stage is absolutely required, and this is a fact which is conventionally ignored. Conclusion of the study is, as per the opinion of various professionals, India IBUS got a valid accepted content validity index at a scale level that is 0.80. So India IBUS can be incorporated in various multidisciplinary NICU setting to promote neurodevelopmental care at early stages of life. Limitations. Multidisciplinary NICU system is lacking in trained manpower to complete this record on daily basis. Time constraint, which is a major issue as while conducting this study due to busy schedule of different healthcare professionals. Even our country is also lacking in infrastructures in many settings. Because of that, there is unavailability of network in NICU settings. It will automatically hamper the digital approach behind the software. These are my references. Thank you. And I would like to acknowledge my guide and all who supported to conduct my study and all the participated professionals. Thank you.
Thank you. Very informative. So I have some clarifications. Your topic is the content validity.
Yes, sir.
You developed some new software.
Yes, yes.
Yeah. So the 10 participants involved in your study, all 10 have software knowledge.
Sir, actually, total 15 participants were enrolled in the study. And first, in the starting, when we have started this study, we introduced about the software and about our study. And later, in the as per I explained, in the third stage of evaluation, we given the access for next 7 to 10 days after explanation. Then in that 7 to 10 days, they did the trial in their own setup or as they want. And later we collected the opinion from these 15 different professionals after that.
My question is, your study is mainly content validity. So that is logical analysis of your item. What are the items present in your software? Yes, so yes. How many items? What about the different opinions? So how many different of opinion in items? Initially, how many items you developed based upon 15 experts? How many items revised, how many items deleted, how many items included? That is not mentioned in your presentation.
Yes, sir, I will mention. Actually, we have collected from the starting opinion from, in the starting stage of development, we collected opinion from 91 professionals in the starting stage of this software. Later, we included various assessment scales, like various scales like BSID, Amilton Battery, InfaNIP. Various scales are there with this with its artificial intelligence. And as per the opinion, we changed the software. We changed some part of the software, and that was also incorporated in the study.
My question is, you mentioned some index value, CVI value.
Yes, yes.
So content validity is a logical analysis of each item. So, but throughout the presentation, you didn't mention the correlation with already established tool, established assessment tool, that is not content validity. That is a criterion validity or concurrent validity.
Sir, actually, as there is a too much of vastness of the content of the software, we decided to stick to some so that it is easy to use and feasible for the professionals. So that's why we decided this 10 and we collected opinion from these professionals regarding that.
So the content validity is all the content present in the particular assessment tool to correctly measure what it intend to measure. That is the content validity meaning.
May I suggest something, Dr. Yes. Ganapathy?
Yes,
I think we'll take this conversation later, but I also have another suggestion to all the participants here, all those who are presenting. When we ask questions, it's not necessary that you will always have the answer and you have to try and find the answer for that particular question. Some of our questions are like comments for you to work upon later. So you don't have to try and evolve that answer, because that answer doesn't really exist. So that's exactly what Dr. Ganapathy's question was. So this is a comment for all the speakers here. Thank you, Prachi, and do continue your work and try and find some of these answers.
Yes, ma'am, we will incorporate and we will correlate with other digital approach. Yes, sir, ma'am.
Yes, thanks, yes. Ma'am. Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Yeah, now we... Yes. Yeah, now we call upon the next speaker, Dr. Aishwarya Swaminathan. And her topic for today is effect of occupational therapy on self-determined routine task performances in a young adult with intellectual disability, a case report. Aishwarya?
Good afternoon, ma'am and sir. Yes. I would like to thank the organizers of the OTCon 2021 and the dignitaries present for this session. And I'll begin my presentation. The topic for today is effect of occupational therapy on self-determined routine task performances in a young adult with intellectual disability. This is a case report. Introduction. Self-determination skills include choice making, planning, goal setting, problem solving, and self-monitoring skills. As per the operational definition, the routine task performances are occupational performances in areas of activities of daily living, instrumental activities of daily living, communication, and work readiness. So the rationale for this case report is to study and understand the effect of teleoccupational therapy on self-determined routine task performances in a young adult with intellectual disability and recent diagnosis of obsessive-compulsive disorder. Patient information. A 19-year-old young adult male patient had a diagnosis of moderate intellectual disability since the age of 3. He has been attending a special school since he was 5 years old and was presently attending school through online telemode due to the COVID pandemic to learn everyday activities, functional academics, and vocational tasks. He started displaying compulsive checking behaviors in the form of repeated opening and closing of windows or doors at the age of 18. And therefore, he got an additional diagnosis of OCD and was started on the medication for the same. Assessment. These were the scales that were used for assessment: routine task inventory, Yale Brown Obsessive Compulsive Scale, Self-Determination Observation Scale, and American Institute of Research Self-Determination Scale. All these scales have been used previously in the intellectual disabled individuals. Tele-assessment was done through parent-teacher interview and observation of performance through Google Meet at week 0, that is pre-occupational therapy intervention. The routine task performance at the baseline of this patient in the areas of ADL, IADL, communication, and work readiness were measured. And then further, it was seen that the compulsive behaviors in this patient was seen in the level of a minimum compulsive behaviors, minimum level. But these were definitely affecting his everyday routine task performances in his everyday living. The level of self-determination was also seen to be affected. The capacity or the potential for self-determination was also seen to be affected, as well as the opportunities that are provided by the parent as well as the educator to participate in these self-determined routine tasks were also affected in this particular patient. Intervention. The occupational therapy intervention was provided through online telemode for 30 minutes per day, 3 days a week for 8 weeks as part of the patient's online school activity. Google Meet platform was used for the tele-OT. iPads were used as remote devices by both the patient as well as the therapist. The comprehensive tele-OT included some components of modified cognitive behavioral therapy and self-determination training. And this was provided in the context of routine task performances at home from where the patient attended the online sessions with assistance of his parent, that is mother, and online educator. Since every week had three sessions, it included one session each of routine tasks during each session from the ADL, IADL, and vocational activity. So these were provided as one-step activity or two-step activity and were provided in real or in the form of a simulated activities. ADL that were provided were activities of grooming, dressing, bathing, feeding. And IADL activities which were concentrated on were housekeeping, preparing, obtaining food, spending money, doing laundry, shopping, telephoning. And vocational activities like candle making, chocolate making, paper bag making, toran making were given to the participant. And stressing on work readiness, that is maintenance of pace and schedule, following instructions and planning the work. During these routine task activities, the components of CBT and combined with the SDT were provided. And for exposure response prevention and antecedent control, social stories were used to explain rules prior to the activity about not getting up during the activity to open or close the windows of the rooms. Which were also used for the following: in giving choice cards for making activity choices from various options, choosing number of the activity from options, setting goals, problem solving, and self-monitoring. Assertiveness training was also given so that the subject could have a positive self-talk, that is, yes, I can, to overcome the urges to indulge in the OCD behaviors and also communicate effectively with the therapist, parent, and educator during the sessions to reduce anxiety. Once the activity was completed, the participant received positive reinforcement in the form of visual star card and or verbal prize. Parent, mother, and the educator were trained to use these components of CBT and SDT with the young patient adult. Clinical findings and discussions. Teleassessment was again done through parent-teacher interview and observation of performance through Google Meet at week 9, that is post-occupational therapy intervention. The compulsive behaviors decreased post-intervention as rated by the therapist, parent, and the educator, as can be seen on the screen. In the present case report, the modified CBT, which included a lot of visual cues, visual support that was given to the patient, provided in the context of routine task performances, may have compensated for the stress of compulsions and thus reduced the OCD behaviors. This is supported by a study by Bavaro, in which the author explains that occupational therapy using combination of psychotherapy and providing non-threatening environment in which patients feel free to express their choices or needs helps in reducing the obsessive-compulsive behaviors. The level of self-determination also improved post-intervention, both in terms of the capacity as well as the opportunities that are provided to the patient to display these self-determination skills in terms of the routine task performances. And this could have been possible because of the self-determination training that was provided with components of visual cues, which were used for choice making, goal setting, planning, problem solving, and self-monitoring of these tasks. This is in accordance with a study by Vincente et al. The authors state that though individuals with disabilities are less self-determined than their peers without disabilities, however, their self-determination skills can be improved with appropriate training, supports, and opportunities. These opportunities for self-determined participation in routine task performances were provided by the OT intervention in the present study. The routine task performances of the patient also improved post-intervention in all the areas, that is ADL, IADL, communication, and work readiness. And in this case report, the improved self-determination skills may have led to improved routine task performances. This is supported by the study by Kelly et al. The authors state that improved self-determination skills can lead to improved task performances and decreased off-task performances. So perspectives. The patient mentioned that he liked using the choice cards because of the limited communication that he could have. The parent and the teachers mentioned that though the patient had the capacity for self-determination, they were not providing him with the necessary opportunities for practicing these self-determination skills earlier to the study. And then they mentioned that they would continue to use these methods to provide him with the opportunities for displaying the self-determination skills during the routine task activities. Conclusion. Overall, it was observed that the occupational therapy had a positive effect on the self-determined routine task performances of ADL, IADL, communication, and work behaviors, which are important occupational performance areas for this young adult with intellectual disability and OCD. Limitation of this study is that the results cannot be generalized due to the single subject design. Future research can be conducted on similar lines using designs like one group pre-test, post-test design or two group comparative studies. These are my references and acknowledgements. Thank you.
Are there any questions here?
No, ma'am, there are no questions in the chat, Q&A.
Yeah, so there are no questions there. I wonder if the participants have gone for a long tea break here, because it looks like we are doing some Viva exams or something like that. So I would request all the participants here who are attending this particular wonderful session to come up with their questions and understand more about the topics. Aishwarya, I wanted to ask you one thing that... just a comment. Talking about an adult who could understand few cognitive approaches. So I wonder whether you could have had a mixed study and added some poly inputs about, you know, getting a perspective of the child, of that adult, getting the perspective from the mother. And also, why did you choose a particular activity to build the child's skills? The adult skills. I mean, those kind of things would have added the to the flavor of your study. So otherwise, you know, I mean, you're looking at a adult who wants to change, who wants to bring about a change within himself. I think for us, it would have been very interesting to hear why he wanted a change and how did he see the change or how did his mother see the change?
Yes, ma'am. Yes.
Yeah? Yes. Dr. Ganpati, if you have any questions.
Yeah, I have one suggestion. What about your adult level intellectual disability, mild, moderate, or severe?
Sir, he was a moderate level, so he couldn't express completely well as verbally. But the main, what I wanted to see in the study was even these moderately intellectual disabled children, they will have these self-determination skills, but many a times we don't give them those opportunities. So if given these opportunities for choice making, for being part of their own activities that they do, so then that will be better for the child. I mean, for the young adult, sorry. Yeah.
Any rationale for your protocol?
For the activities that I've used in the study? Huh. Sir, I've read articles which have mentioned about these modified cognitive behavioral therapies which use these visual inputs so that it can be used in them. And as well as the self-determination training also, all are based on previous evidences. So activities have been taken from them.
The next speaker is Dr. Sheba Parveen, and her topic for today is a scoping review on touching private parts behavior in young children 2 to 6 years diagnosed with autism spectrum disorder.
I'm not shocked. It's fine. I was. Thank you, ma'am. Good afternoon, everyone. So the topic of my presentation, the paper is a scoping review on touching private parts behavior in young children who are diagnosed with autism spectrum disorder. Before I would like to proceed, is my screen visible and am I audible?
Yes, dear.
Okay, thank you, ma'am. So as we all know that childhood sexual development and the sexual behavior of young children with disabilities is an area of research that remains particularly neglected. Although touching or pressing private parts are being observed in clinical settings during therapy or intervention, parents are often reluctant to report these behavior as part of their behavioral concerns, although they are particularly disturbed by the same. And parents and therapists, they often categorize these behavior as sexual behavior or inappropriate sexual behavior. So previous studies and systematic reviews, they state that these behavior tend to be related to varied factors such as curiosity, impulsivity, anxiety, or trauma-related symptoms, or at times attention seeking. So the clinical presentation of touching private parts or rubbing private parts somehow like appears like this. So the objective of this study was to understand these behavior, that is touching, pressing, and rubbing private parts in young children who are 2 to 6 years of age. However, it is very interesting to note that the sexual behavior, according to American Academy of Pediatrics, the normal and the common behaviors, touching and masturbating genitals in public and private, comes under the normal and the common behavior. Similarly, viewing or touching peer or new sibling genitals or showing genitals to peers or standing or sitting too close or tries to view peer adult nudity or behaviors which are transient, few and distractible, they all come under the normal common behaviors. And the behaviors which are like rarely normal includes the sexual behaviors which involve who are like children who are 4 or more years apart and who usually, they basically sexual behavior which are associated with other physically aggressive behavior or sexual behavior that involve coercion or behaviors which are persistent and child will become angry if distracted from that. So my study design was scoping review and the methodology was the PubMed and the different search engines were used and publications were included between January 2000 to November 2020, which reported the touching private part. And it was combined with the term autism spectrum disorder in young children. And the single case study designs were also included in the review. The inclusion criteria was that the studies which were required to have been published in academic or the peer-reviewed journals and published in English. And the studies which included touching or rubbing private part were included in ASD. Exclusion criteria, that studies which were talking about the sexual abuse or epileptic seizures were excluded from the study. So according to the studies which we have found, compulsive masturbation in infantile autism, there is a 5-year-old autistic child who was admitted into the hospital for the same reason, that is compulsive masturbation, and inappropriate hypersexual behavior, which is consisted of compulsive public masturbation, and how it has been treated with a drug, emerzapine. Similarly, another study which is talking about the gratification disorder, it was a review. And again, the major findings of this review is that there is little published on gratification disorder or masturbation in early childhood. And misdiagnosis at times occurs when epileptic disorders, it is basically misdiagnosed with epileptic disorder when the child is adducting thighs. Similarly, according to another study which is talking about the diagnosis and the treatment of early childhood masturbation in a case of autism spectrum disorder, it's an interesting study which is talking about a 30-month-old girl who is referred to the hospital for language delay and the behavioral problems and the lower limb contraction. And it was a case report. And it was basically trying, the major findings of this article was that it is basically intending to raise the awareness that childhood masturbation is a common process. And again, it was treated with a drug, escitalopram, added to the treatment along with the behavioral management to reduce these behavior. Similarly, another study which is talking about the clinical and the demographic factors which are associated with sexual behavior in children with autism spectrum disorder. This study was conducted at a school for learners with autism spectrum disorder. And basically, there were questionnaires which were talking about the family stability, the clinical profile, and the reported sexual behavior in their children. Again, the major findings of this study was that there is problem in defining inappropriate sexual behavior. Firstly, to identify what is appropriate sexual behavior, and then only we can identify what is inappropriate sexual behavior in this study.
Similarly, there was a systematic review where they are talking about the inappropriate sexual behavior of children and adolescents with developmental disabilities. And this review provides a systematic analysis and intervention for inappropriate sexual behavior of children and adolescents with developmental disability. And again, in this study, they are talking about that children with ASD are frequently engaging in public masturbation, inappropriate touching of other or fetishistic behavior. But again, given the paucity of studies in this area, there are restricted terminologies which is being used. And again, the potential efficacious treatment for inappropriate sexual behavior is again cannot be determined. So it should be noted from these studies that although the term sexual is used, the reason for engaging in such behavior in the age group of 2 to 6 years does not logically seem to be related to sexual gratification or stimulation. And the studies were described to state the various clinical and demographic factors which were associated with sexual behavior or inappropriate sexual behavior. The conclusion of the study was that there are studies about sexual behavior in adolescent as a part of sexuality and sexual development, but touching private parts in early childhood are still not being studied or described with much emphasis. There seems to be a gap about the terminology and the operational definition or whether or not they should be separated from the age-appropriate sexual development. And again, because there is a lack of the terminologies and the operational definition, the underlying reason for these and how to plan an intervention for these children can only be taken up only after there is a body of knowledge and understanding about them. So according to the discussion that the children with ASD, they all go through the same process of sexual maturation and development as a neurotypical adolescent. Social awareness, reciprocal social interaction, and adequate communication skills are essential in the learning and understanding of appropriate sexual behavior. Unfortunately, these are exactly the areas in which individual with ASD shows impairment. And further research has to be done in this area for the sexual development and the behavior of children with ASD. And obviously, there were a few articles which were talking about that there is a lot of stigma attached to these terms. And there is reluctance of the caregivers to discuss about the sexual behavior of their children. So the possible limitation again for this review was that this area is so under-researched, it is hard to draw any conclusion because there seems to be a lack in the body of the knowledge, or like lack of the operational definition and the lack of the knowledge, particularly with respect to this topic. So these are my references and yeah. So yeah, thank you.
Any questions there?
Yes, ma'am, there are a couple of questions in the Q&A.
Yes, please, go ahead. I cannot somehow see those.
It is in the down near to the participants, Q&A and chat.
Yeah, I know that, but okay.
You have to scroll down.
Okay, one. Yeah, got it. I think the first question is, if it was normal, Shiva, why do you think it was pharmacologically treated? Because you mentioned in your paper, in your study that there...
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah.
Ma'am, actually, my emphasis of pharmacological management of this is that according to American Academy of Pediatrics, it is considered as a normal behavior, the childhood masturbation. But in the articles, they are trying to, you know, taking it as a part of a uncommon behavior or inappropriate social behavior. And they are trying to use the drug to reduce it, this behavior.
Okay.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. And the second question is, what is the implication of this study? And which also is my question to you, actually.
Yes, ma'am. Ma'am, actually, we always see touching private part or rubbing private part in our clinical setups whenever we see. And at times, parents, they do not report it. And at times, they think that it is more like a sexual thing. But in a child, the reason I have chosen the age group is 2 to 6 years is because we cannot consider it as a sexual gratification, right? I mean, it is something related to that if they are trying to rub or like, you know, touching their private part, it could be something related to the sensory, like we are not looking at it from the sensory lens as well. So there is seems to be a lack of a body of knowledge where we have to like we can actually go and refer this to. So the implication was just to understand the fact that touching private part should be come under what category, because there are articles which are talking about the sexual behavior, taking it under sexual behavior, taking it under compulsive masturbation, taking it under inappropriate sexual behavior.
Okay. would that affect your clinical reasoning in any ways? That, I mean, you know,
yes,
why the that's again, I think that's the implication of this. How is it going to affect your clinical reasoning while you're working with 2 to 6 years? The age group is something which is extremely alarming, and we don't want to send wrong signals to people. So that's the reason I think everybody is asking the same question. Do you agree with me, Dr. Ganpati?
Yes, ma'am.
Do you agree with what I said just now, Dr. Ganpati? Would you? Because then that way we can have just one question and end her discussion.
Mainly, first we have to analyze the reasoning behind this kind of behavior. It is mainly pure behavior or sensory issues.
Yes, sir.
So it will be helpful for formulate intervention program.
Exactly, sir. Yes, yes, sir. Absolutely. So because until or unless we don't know the reason for it, and how do we have to, like, where do we have to refer these cases to? Like, obviously we are looking at it from occupational therapy point of view, but the articles which we are getting is at times they're talking about the gratification disorder under this symptoms. They're talking about the inappropriate sexual behavior under this terminology, but no article is actually talking about this, like looking at it from the sensory lens, or like how do we have to intervene until we do have a like a good operational definition for them. Because the idea of conducting this scoping review was just to see whether do we have to call this as a sexual thing, or do we have to give it another terminology, or gratification disorder, like that.
Yes. I think, yes. Shiva, let's not get into diagnosing the condition. Firstly, I would say is, you know, you are coming up with so many not scientifically evidence-based sentences that it's extremely alarming. And especially when we are talking about an age group of 2 to 6. Let's not get into the diagnosis say whether we want to put it under any criteria. Yes, but I'm sure you will continue with your work. Thank you.
Ma'am. Sure. Thank you so much, ma'am.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Now, if Durga Prasad is ready, maybe.
Yes, sir.
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, invite Durga Prasad. You can proceed now.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir, for giving me the opportunity again. Good afternoon, everyone. My topic of presentation is dysfunctional behavior and associated risk factor in children with autism in Eastern India. Introductions. Children with autism spectrum disorder show dysfunctional behavior, including internalizing and externalizing problems. Dysfunctional behavior impacts daily functioning and causes increased burden and distress to parents and increase the societal cost of the services. The etiology may be due to biological factors like genetic and somatic conditions and environmental factors like inability to communicate and interact with others. For proper intervention of dysfunctional behaviors and the long-term prognosis of ASD, a better understanding of their risk factors is needed. Review of literature. Children aged 3 to 5 years with ASD exhibit more frequent and severe internalizing behavior, which includes obsession, compulsions, anxiety, emotional reactivity, and externalizing behavior, including inattentions. And tics. Several studies suggest a high prevalence of aggressive behavior in children with ASD aged 3 to 5 years. Few studies have examined the prevalence of dysfunctional behavior that occur at a clinical significant level in young children with autism. Researchers have not examined the comorbidity and the extent to which young children with ASD exhibit multiple dysfunctional behaviors at a clinical significant levels. Individuals with ASD with low cognitive functioning and adaptive behavior exhibit more dysfunctional behavior than high functioning individuals. Expressive language is negatively correlated with dysfunctional behavior in older children with autism spectrum disorder. Severity of autism, autistic behavior has also been shown to be positively associated with dysfunctional behavior in older children with ASD. Several studies report no gender differences in dysfunctional behavior, but few studies reveals girls with ASD have been shown to exhibit a slightly higher frequency or severity of a few dysfunctional behaviors. Researchers have demonstrated that increased screen time is associated with greater behavior problems among children. Many research also suggest an association between behavior problem in children and their habit of caffeine consumption. Also, physical activity affects behavior problem in children. The findings from previous study are limited as young children were included within the broader ASD continuum, which may not truly reflect the profiles of dysfunctional behavior. To clearly understand about dysfunctional behavior, research using samples of young children with specific ASD diagnosis is needed. We have shown that there is a strong positive association between ASD symptom severity and dysfunctional behavior in children with ASD, but this study are limited. Dysfunctional behavior affects intervention reports and negatively impact long-term prognosis of autism. For proper assessment and to devise appropriate intervention strategy, better understanding of different dysfunctional behavior is needed. Objectives: to identify the prevalence of clinical significant dysfunctional behaviors and their associated factors among children aged 2 to 6 year old diagnosed with autism. Methodology: study locations, Kalinga Institute of Medical Science and Bhubaneswar Institute of Interventional Psychiatry, Behavioral Science and Research, Bhubaneswar, India. Study duration was 3 months. Sample size, assuming the prevalence of dysfunctional behavior in children with autism is 50%, with 10% accepted margin of error and 95% level of confidence, sample size was determined as 96. Screening tool use Indian Scale for Assessment of Autism, and outcome measure we use child behavior checklist. Study design was cross-sectional. Inclusion and exclusion criteria. Inclusion criteria include 2 to 6 year old male child with autism. Exclusion criteria include children with severe and profound mental retardation, visual hearing impairment, physical disability, recent brain hemorrhage, stroke, cerebral aneurysm, brain injury or tumors, Down syndrome, rheumatoid arthritis. Children suffering from any complex neurological disorder like cerebral palsy, phenylketonuria, tuberous sclerosis, neurofibromatosis, unstable seizure disorder, Rett's disorder, or those using drugs having any probable effect on behavior and sleep, like antihistamine, CNS stimulant, anticonvulsants, etc. Procedure. Mothers of selected children who willing to participate were involved and written informed consent was taken. Sociodemographic information was taken through a semi-structured schedule. CBCL means child behavior checklist for age 1.5 through 5 year was administered to measure the dysfunctional behaviors. All the data were analyzed using IBM SPSS version 21.0. In order to identify the risk factor for dysfunctional behavior, stepwise logistic regression analysis were applied. The level of two-tailed statistical significance was set at p-value less than 0.05. Ethical issues. Written informed consent was obtained from the mothers of eligible children before initiation of the study. The research protocol was divided according to declaration of Helsinki. Results, first table show the socio-demographic characteristics of the study populations. Second table show the mean scores, clinical significant percentage and reliability analysis of CBCL domains. Third show the multivariate logistic regressive model showing the relationship of each syndrome scale with socio-demographic characteristics. And fourth table show the multivariate logistic regression model showing the relationship of each syndrome scale with other syndrome scales. Fifth show the final multivariate logistic regression model showing the predictors of each syndrome scales. Sixth table show the multivariate logistic regression model showing the predictors of composite scales. This can be inferred from the tables that 88% of children with autism had a CBCL total problem score in clinical significant range. 88% and 43% children had clinical significant internalizing and externalizing problems respectively. The CBCL syndrome scale with highest percentage of clinical significant scores were withdrawn 94%, sleep problems 58%, attention problem 58%. Overall, 92% of children with autism had more than one CBCL syndrome scale in the clinical significant range, indicating high degree of comorbidity of clinical significant dysfunctional behavior. Several risk factors such as autism severity, screen time, caffeine consumption for dysfunctional behavior were identified. Discussions. Dysfunctional behaviors are more frequent in children with autism as compared to their typically developing peers and peers with intellectual disability because of other etiology. In our study, 88% of young children with autism had a CBCL total problem score in clinical significant range, which is higher than the finding of earlier study using the CBCL. The mean total problem score in our study sample was 78.94, which is higher than the results reported in other studies. In this study, 58% of children with autism were rated exhibiting a clinical significant level of attention problem, and this is consistent with the reports of previous studies. A high rate of comorbidity of dysfunctional behavior was observed in children with autism, as 92% of the children with autism were rated as having more than one clinical significant dysfunctional behaviors. children consuming caffeinated beverages more frequently in a week, means more than 3 days per week, were more likely to be emotionally reactive than their counterparts. Children with autism having anxious and depressed mood, somatic complaints, and attention problem were at higher risk of being emotionally reactive. An increase in screen time was positively associated with sleep problem in children with autism. Overall, this study presents a strong positive association between internalizing and externalizing behavior problems. Conclusion. The prevalence of clinical significant dysfunctional behavior is very high among children with autism. Finding from this study highlights the urgent need for designing appropriate management strategy incorporating risk factors such as autism severity, screen time, and caffeine consumptions. Most importantly, careful assessment and early intervention should be aimed at children with autism from a very early age to improve the quality of life of these children. Limitations and future recommendations. The finding may not be generalized to older children with autism in different settings from a wide geographical area, as this study is limited to Bhubaneswar only. Further research is warranted in diverse settings to assess the prevalence of clinical significant dysfunctional behavior and identify additional risk factor in other ASD groups and comparing the similarities or dissimilarities between the groups. These are my references. Thank you.
One suggestion from participant, the title should be as behavioral dysfunction in children.
Behavioral dysfunction. Sir, actually, I think so many titles like maladaptive behavior, behavioral dysfunctions, and any limitations of behavior. But this dysfunctional behavior seems more appealing. That's why I kept it.
So next, you are, I have one question.
Yes, sir.
Your presentation, you mentioned 2 to 6 years.
Yes, sir.
So for autism diagnosis, usually the DSM-4 and DSM-5 applicable after 3 years only.
Yes.
So how would you children?
Yes, sir. Actually, through ISA, I diagnosed Indian Scale for Assessment of Autism, which includes 2 years also. And most of the autism symptoms starts appearing from 18 months onward. After patient get noticed and see the symptoms of regressions. That's why I used 2 to 6 years.
And I can give you some suggestion. The regression, yes, you can call as the Rett syndrome. So at the age,
yes,
there is significant, there is no significant prenatal, natal, postnatal injury. After 6 to 18 months, any time some regression may be occurred. Then we can, based on history, we can diagnose as Rett disorder.
Yeah.
So not comes under autism. Because your in your research, you used CBCL, Childhood Behavior Checklist. That scale is based, yes, on DSM-4, Diagnostic Statistical Manual 4. So
yeah,
another one is CBCL have 2 versions. So which version,
yes,
you study, preschool version or school version?
It's a preschool version, 1.5 to 5 years.
Okay. Thank you. Ma'am, do you have any comments, ma'am?
Thank you.
No, the only comment actually I had was, you've written in the limitations that the study is probably applicable only for eastern part of India, but I somehow don't see that as that the need to mention that is there, because I really don't think that the problems or the issues that you mentioned would be specifically only for Bhubaneswar. And across, I think, all these papers, my common input or suggestion is, what have you done to, you know, to mitigate the challenges? Because everybody has been talking about challenges which are very well known and prevalent across globe, but it would be interesting, yeah, to hear from an occupational therapist, what are you doing or what have you done, even in a small portion or small percentage, to mitigate the problem. But I'm sure you will look at that as your next topic of discussion or present paper in the next conference. Thank you.
Yes, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am.
Yes. I believe there is going to be a slight change because Dr. Maud is not, there's some net issue there. So,
speaker, ma'am. One more speaker is there.
Oh, yeah. Sorry. I'm so sorry. Yes. Sorry, Dr. Thank Sujata.
I invite Dr. Sujata Mishal for the presentation. Her topic is effect of pinosotaping on seated postural control in children with cerebral palsy.
Good afternoon to all. A very warm welcome to the chairpersons, and also I want to wish the participants as well as the audience. I thank the organizing committee also for giving me this opportunity to do my presentation. The topic for my presentation is effect of kinesiotaping on seated postural control in children with cerebral palsy. Posture and sitting problems are common in children with CP. Pelvis and trunk controls are essential for sitting mobility, the development of the upper extremity, as well as pulmonary functions and activities of daily living. Various rehabilitative interventions such as NDT, hypotherapy, neuromuscular electrical stimulation has been found to be effective on sitting and posture in children with CP. But lately, kinesiotaping is commonly being used in rehabilitation settings due to its several advantages. KT developed by Kenzo Kase reported that KT facilitates circulation, improves tissue alignment, corrects muscle function, and provides positional stimuli. Therefore, therapeutic taping focuses on improving the information feedback as well as stabilizing the body for functional control. According to Simsek et al., they have reported that KT has been effective on sitting, yet not on functional and motor parameters. In a pilot study, immediate effects of KT have been studied, whereby neuromuscular taping seems to be effective on dynamic activities, but not in static activities. Moreover, Kaya Kara et al. Have reported that KT increases the proprioceptive feedback and gross motor function and ADL in children with cerebral palsy. Previous studies focused more on the combination of different modalities to achieve better function status in CP children. However, effects of KT in addition to conventional occupation therapy has not yet been studied yet. The study hypothesized that children who received KT plus conventional occupation therapy would show better seated postural control compared with children who received conventional occupation therapy and no program only. Aims and objectives of the study was to find the effectiveness of kinesiotaping on seated postural control in children with cerebral palsy. The objective was to find out immediate effect of kinesiotaping on seated postural control and also to analyze the effect of KT on sitting postural control after 6 weeks and 12 weeks of intervention. The methodology was the children included in the studies were children with diagnosed with cerebral palsy, except etetoid CP, age group between 1 to 6 years of age, children who have not participated in any previous trials with adhesive taping to the trunk musculature, children classified on the basis of gross motor function classification system, expanded and revised for cerebral palsy, level 4 for children between 2 to 4 years and 4 to 6 years, and level 3 and level 4 for children below 2 years of age were taken for the study. Exclusion criteria were children who demonstrated allergic reactions to the adhesive neuromuscular taping, children who had seizures and children who have open wounds, children who had surgically implanted spinal instrumentation, and children with severe spasticity. Tools and materials used was screening tool was GMFCS and for selecting the children for the study. Outcome measure tools were segmental assessment of trunk control, that is SATCO, and Chaley's level of ability scale. And the methodology, if you see the study design was a pre-post-test study design, and convenient sampling with a random allocation to group 1 and group 2 was done. The sample size was calculated using Rao's of sample size calculator software at 95% of confidence interval. For a population of 3 out of 1,000 children in India, sample size was estimated to be 18. Out of these 18, 2 children dropped out because they were not able to come regularly for the therapy. So only 16 children diagnosed with spastic cerebral palsy were taken for the study. And there were 9 children in group 1 and 7 children in group 2. And subjects in group 1 received kinesiotaping and trunk control musculature and conventional occupation therapy, while group 2 received home program and conventional occupation therapy. The study was conducted at Kowai Medical Center in the Department of Occupational Therapy and also two other early intervention centers in Coimbatore, which is called as Vidya Vikasani Center and AIM Child Development Center. Procedure that we adopted was first we got an ethical approval from the KMCH Institutional Ethical Committee. All participants were assessed at baseline, immediate and 6 weeks and 12th week using SATCO and Chaley levels of ability. And subjects were randomly assigned to group 1 and 2. And group 1 went through kinesiotaping and group 2 went through the conventional OT. For group one, the taping was applied over the trunk muscles and effects were assessed immediately after the application of the tape, after 6 weeks and then after 12 weeks of intervention. Whereas group two underwent home program as well as conventional therapy and the effects were assessed after 6th and 12th week of a intervention. For group one, the intervention was, we used an eye tape, eye strip for from the kinesotape, and both the paraspinal muscles and lower trapezius muscles were taped. Taping was done for erector spinae muscle, basically from S1 to C7, which were, we used more of a facilitatory technique, that is origin to insertion application. And for lower trapezius, the application of the kinesotape was done from T12 to upper border of the spinoscapula, as well as up to the level of the acromion process, which is again the insertion point of the lower trapezius. To facilitate the muscle, tape was applied from origin to insertion. If inhibition was required, it was applied from insertion to origin. But we had most of the clients who were spastic. That's why we did not use inhibitory approach. Rather, we used only the facilitatory approach. The tape was held in position for 3 days, after which the region was left for rest for 1 day to allow the skin for perspiration. And then a new tape was reapplied on the 5th day. The tape application was continued up to 12 weeks. Where the intervention for group two was basically all the conventional occupational therapy program, the activities which included facilitation of rolling, activities to facilitate static and dynamic sitting, facilitation of different sitting positions and reaching activities, positioning to improve sitting posture using adaptive sitting device, and activities to facilitate active trunk extension, writing and equivalent reactions on the therapy ball, weight-bearing activities from different sitting positions, from quadruped position, and facilitation of reach, grasp, release, transferring of objects. So this is how this picture shows how the taping was done from S1 to C7 and then from T12 to towards the acromion process. Both the pictures show the same. And this was a conventional program that was given for the children, both at home as well as in the department, as well as in the early intervention centers. Now, coming to data analysis and results, Wilcoxon scientists and Mann-Whitney U-tests were used to evaluate within and between group differences. And the level of significance was based at 0.05. Effect size was also calculated. Results were tabulated into tables and graphs as follows. The demographic details of the clients who participated for the study were, in group one, there were 9 participants, 6 boys and 3 girls of mean age 2.8 plus minus 1.22. All were at GM FCS level 4. In group 2, there were 7 participants, 5 CP quadri and 2 CP diplegic, 4 boys and 3 girls of mean age 2.9 and plus minus 0.88. All were at the level of level 4, and one child was at level 5 of GMCS FCS. Then coming to table, within group comparison of SATCO and Chellis, in group one, if you see, there is significance in all areas, that is in SATCO as well as in Chiley's level of ability in supine prone floor sitting except box sitting. Then in table two, we can see there is no significance in any of whether in SATCO scale as well as in Chiley scale. This graph shows the comparison of pretest, immediate, mid, post-test scores of SATCO and Chiley, and we can see that in immediate, pretest to immediate, the first graph, there is no difference, but immediate to 6 week, there is a change, and in SATCO, then immediate to, 6th to 12th week, again, there is a slight change. Similarly, if you go through the Chiley scale, immediate, there is a very slight difference. In immediate to 6th week, again, a slight difference. Then in immediate to post-test, there is not much of a difference. And gradually, if you see in Chiley's, there is not much of a, it shows not much of a difference. Just very minimal changes are being noticed. Then in again, in graph two, if we see comparison of pretest and midtest and post-test scores in SATCO and Chiley's in group one, there is difference between the pretest, midtest, as well as the post-test. In all, there is a considerable change. Graph 3 shows comparison of pretest, midtest, post-test scores of SATCO and Chiley in group 2. Here we can see there is a change in both post-test to midtest in SATCO, midtest to post-test in sorry, pre-test to mid-test in SATCO, mid-test to post-test in SATCO. Similarly, in Chinese also, there is a slight change and considerable improvement as it goes by. In graph 4, if you see comparison of pre-test, mid-test, post-test score of SATCO and Chinese, here also in group 2, we can see compared to pre-test, post-test and mid-test, there has been a considerable improvement in the both the scales. Comparison of SATCO scores between group 1 and group 2, when there was a comparison done, it was found that there was no significant difference in all the areas, whether it was in SATCO or whether it this is for SATCO. There was no significant difference between both the groups. Again, in Chile also, this table shows about Chile's group 1 and 2 comparison. Here also, there was no significant difference in all the areas of floor sitting, box sitting, or whether it was supine on prone lying position. There was no significant changes between the groups when the test was done. Therefore, a effect size was calculated to know whether there was a change in the group 1 or group 2 more. And when the effect size was calculated, it was found that there was a moderate amount of difference in especially the experimental group in SATCO. That is, but whereas in Chinese, there was not much of a difference in any of the supine, prone, floor sitting or box sitting positions or levels of ability. Coming to discussion, the present study results indicate there is improvement in sitting postural control post-intervention in both the groups. In a study done by Knox and Evans, 15 children with CP at level 5 GMCS were administered NDT. They reported that the gross motor function measure scores were improved as a result of treatment, which is why even in our study, we found that conventional OT group showed improvements following therapy. Even though there was improvement in scores in both the groups, significant improvement in sitting postural control was seen only in group 1 as indicated by the SATCO score. There was no significant improvement in box sitting ability in both the groups, but there was considerable improvement in floor sitting ability, supine and prone level of the ability in Chile's level of ability. Present study findings are also consistent with the study of Roy Dixit on spastic diplegic children who received kinesiotaping, which was applied over paraspinal region. And in addition to that, they gave reactive postural adjustment and anticipatory postural adjustment therapeutic activity program. And they found that improvement in functional sitting and trunk control in the participants. It was observed that participants in the present study didn't show significant improvement after immediate kinesiotaping application in sitting postural control, but they showed a significant improvement in seated postural control after 12th week. The significant improvement may not have been noticed immediately of following KT. The reason could be because maybe we have not used a very sensitive scale to detect the changes. Maybe a EMG study would have helped to detect the significant changes, immediate significant changes. Therefore, it is advisable that future studies increase the duration of taping for more than 12 weeks so that there will be better functional improvement after the taping procedure. It was also observed that there was no significant improvement after immediate application of tape. And the lack of improvement may also be attributed to the severity of the motor involvement of the participants included in the study, as the present study included participants classified at the lower levels of GMCS, FCS. This is consistent with the study finding of Knox, who studied children classified at lower functioning levels. In his study, he included participants of GMFCS level 4 and 5 and reported smaller changes in scores on the gross motor function measure. So Roy and Dixit also conducted a study on effectiveness of Lycra garments, and they also found improved stability and motor skill acquisition. And they found there was no change elicited in children with profound motor impairment. So that could be a reason if we have children who are at 4 and 5 level of GMFCS, the changes could not be found much. Effect size for Chile in prone floor sitting were found to be small. And for SATCO, it was found to be medium in group 1.
Ma'am, may I interrupt,
to confirm please? That kinesiotaping had positive impact on improving seated postural control. This is in line with the findings of Knox study, which claims that kinesiotaping could stimulate cutaneous mechanoreceptors and thus improve the proprioceptive inputs for muscles to perform task-specific functions. So to conclude, we can say that kinesiotaping on trunk muscles accounted for improvement in sitting postural control and can be considered as an effective intervention. Kinesiotaping led to improved functioning in supine prone floor sitting ability and sitting postural control compared to the control group who received only the home program and conventional occupational therapy. It was also observed that kinesio taping didn't bring about a significant improvement in sitting posture control immediately after the application of the tape, but 12 weeks after, there was a considerable or better functioning in the children. This indicates that a longer duration of intervention could lead to better functioning, functional improvement after taping. Finally, the study provides evidence for the use of using kinesio taping as a promising additional approach for increasing proprioceptive feedback and improving seated posture control in children with cerebral palsy. So these were my limitations, a small sample size, there was no follow-up, and participants were more on the moderate to severe impairment, motor impairment. Duration of the study, recommendations are, maybe we use more longer duration of intervention for kinesio taping. Follow-up study can be done to find out its long-term effect, and further studies can be done on different kinds of, to compare the findings of KT on different types of cerebral palsy. I would like to thank all the children, parents, and early intervention centers for the kind cooperation and willingness to participate in the study. I would also like to thank our chairman and managing trustee of KMCH for granting permission to conduct the data collection in our institution.
Thank you, ma'am. Informative session.
These are my references. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. The participants have raised some questions. The first question is, what is the reason to exclude the children with seizure in your study? What is the reason to exclude children with seizures, epilepsy in your study?
Some studies say that it can increase, some of the studies say that it can increase the seizure activity. That is the reason it was excluded. K-taping can increase the seizure activity in the children.
Is this a research from a peer-reviewed article that kinesio taping can increase seizure activity?
Yes, from, I'm not very sure whether it's a peer review, but there is evidence stating that it can stimulate, because there is increased flow of blood circulation, they say, and there is also increased in lymphatic flow. So indirectly, it can cause a stimulation to the neuromuscular system, and thereby it can cause.
Okay. The second question, ma'am.
Yeah. No, go ahead. I think
sample size calculation was 3/1,000 children. What the source of this? What was the accepted mean difference for the sample calculation? What was the accepted mean difference for the sample calculation?
Yeah, I'm not very sure about this because this was done by the statistician. So whatever the statistician has given me, I've just used that as a sample size.
Ma'am, do you have any question, ma'am, your side?
No, I think we've really crossed the time limit. So let me just end here. And I think only comment I have is kinesio taping. I'm assuming that the kinesio taping Dr. Sujata is talking about is the original kinesio tape and not the India-made kinesio tape, which comes as a kinesio tape and really not effective. And secondly, I think as therapists, we need to be cognizant of one thing is there are a lot of studies which say movement-based activities are more effective than using kinesio tape. So I think we all need to be aware of the research which says that it's more of dynamic movements which are going to make a change in the child's life as compared to really going forward and looking at expensive kinesio tape. Yeah, but thanks.
Yeah, that way, KT actually helps in bringing about more dynamic movement and not restricting the movements. That's an advantage of KT, basically.
Yeah, but there is, anyway, we'll talk about it later in a different conversation. Thanks a lot.
Thank you. Thank you, ma'am. Thank you.